Okay, great. We shall start proper right now. So, Jeremy speaking here again. So, for today's agenda, we'll be covering a macro and technical perspective on the dollar, and then subsequently cover a little bit on gold and then emerging market. So, for today's presentation, we'll be covering a lot on the weakness that we are seeing within the US dollar itself. And then we'll move on to why we are bullish on gold, that we have been pretty bullish for the past year. And then last but not least, how the emerging markets will sort of a benefit with a weak dollar environment. So without further ado, let's jump straight into it. So for my part of it, I'll be covering more on the US dollar as well as gold. And like I mentioned, we are pretty bearish on the US dollar moving forward. And what we are seeing from this front is that US dollar will have at least another 25 to 30% downside from here. And long-term target for the US dollar moving forward for at least the next 2 to 3 years, the target that we are seeing for the US dollar itself, the dollar index will be at around the $73 mark. And on the flip side, obviously, when the US dollar goes into a circular downtrend, we'll be expecting gold to actually do spectacularly well during such an environment. So on the flip side, on gold, we are actually seeing a 50% upside from current prices on gold, and we are actually targeting gold to retest its 2011 high of 1920 level mark. So here are some of the reasons why we are very bearish on the US dollar itself. So the piece that sort of forms up why we are bearish is from a broad top-down perspective, we are seeing some sort of a cycle playing out within the dollar index here. So what you are seeing here on the screen is the dollar index on a money time frame that spans all the way back to 1970s. So what is interesting over here is we noted that the dollar index actually follows some sort of a cycle, and more specifically it follows a 98 month cycle, whereby in every 98 months period it seems to form a cyclical high, and then subsequently it will head into a circular downtrend. And what I mean by that is you can see on the chart over there that I have actually demarcated vertical lines to mark up the circular peak for each cyclical top. So probably I'll just run through the cycles to illustrate what I mean. So for example, we can see the first cycle took 104 months to form, starting from June 1976, and exactly 104 months later in February of 1985, that was when our first cyclical peak was formed. And you can see every cyclical peak brings about sort of a sell-off in the dollar index, large enough to actually retest its previous low. So during this particular period of this circular downtrend in February of 1985, you can see dollar index actually crumbled 48% all the way back down to the previous decade low over here that was formed back in 1979. This pattern is pretty apparent in all cycles. And I'll just move on. You can see the second cycle took about 108 months to form from 1985 February period all the way to 1994 February period. So you can see the next cyclical high again, same thing over here, brought the dollar index down 15%. And like I mentioned, you can see the move to the downside actually brought the dollar index back to retest its previous low around 1992 period. Third cycle took about 89 months to form from 1994 Fed period to July of 2001. And then same thing again, it caused the dollar index to sell off for about 40%. And as you can see over here, the sell-off again led the dollar index to retest its prior low that was formed around the 1990s period. And where we are right now, the most recent cycle took about 92 months to form. That's the fourth cycle. This is where we are. The fall wasn't really that huge. Nonetheless, the 12% move again took the dollar index back down to retest its prior low that was formed back in 2007. So on average, the cycle sort of takes around 98 months to form. It gives us a very rough estimate of where to actually look out for the cyclical high. And so if you were to use the average of 98 months and using the sort of a benchmark from March of 2009, by extrapolating 98 months from there, we actually get a figure of May of this year to look out for the cyclical high. However, like I mentioned, this is just a guide in terms of us finding where exactly the high is. So we added in some other factors to help us and aid us in actually locating the cyclical peak. And we have come to conclusion that with the benefit of hindsight, what we are seeing is that the January 2017 peak that we have seen at around 103 is the current cyclical high, and that the dollar index is ready to head into a circular downtrend moving forward for at least the next 2 to 3 years. And so our medium-term target for the dollar index, just based on a cyclical point of view, is the 80 level mark that is marked out around this highlighted area, and ultimately to retest the 73 support area that was formed back in around 2007 to 2011 period. The reason why we are sort of calling the January 2017 high to be the current cyclical high within this new cycle is because of price action, as well as some other factors that I will explain more in depth in the following slides. So here is the same chart on dollar index, money time frame, but to illustrate a different perspective. So obviously you can see over here the dollar index is still stuck in a long-term downtrend. And we realize that the dollar index tend to react to key Fibonacci retracement level. For those that are not really familiar with TA, Fibonacci retracement level basically shows us how far price have corrected away from the original trend. So some key levels to watch out for in terms of the Fibonacci retracement level that are of importance are the 50% level mark as well as the 61.8% level mark. So what I want to illustrate over here is you can see over here during the downturn over here back in 1985, that was also one of the cycles that I just pointed out in the previous slide. During this circular downtrend, the dollar index actually fell from this particular high of 1985 all the way to a low in 1992. During this downstretch, we are able to actually draw our Fibonacci retracement level. And then as you can see over here, during the recovery phase since 1994, the downtrend has been kept alive by this 50 Fibonacci retracement level that's being marked up during this particular long-term downtrend. And you can see subsequently, once price starts to fall over this sort of a 50% Fibonacci retracement level, the long-term downtrend just kicked back in again to continue the next cycle of a downturn. Keep in mind over here again, this 2000 to 2001-ish period is also another cyclical high point that I marked out in my previous slide. So where we are right now, why is it important and interesting in terms of the current times is, again, we by using the same kind of analysis, we are able to draw another key Fibonacci retracement level from this particular downtrend over here that was formed back in 2001, stretching all the way to 2007. So during the recovery phase since 2007, you can see what happened is instead of reacting to the 50% FIB levels, right now we are actually reacting to the 61.8% FIB level of this new downtrend. And you can see over here, the price action is pretty similar to the one that we had back in around 2001, whereby price is sort of wobbling and failing to break through this key FIB level. And then coupling that with what I've just mentioned in terms of the cycle, we are right now in a new cycle whereby the dollar index is ready to head into a circular downtrend. Everything is lining up in terms of telling us that the dollar index is weak and is sort of really flipping over into a circular downtrend right now. And to add further evidence in terms of why we are bearish, just like to bring your attention to the bottom panel here, which shows the relative strength index, RSI. So a brief explanation of what RSI shows is momentum. And a reading above 70, which is this red line over here, tells us that we are in an overbought condition and that there's a high chance that prices is ready to head into a correction. And then on the flip side, if the RSI is below 30, it tells us that the price is oversold. So what has been happening more recently is you can see over here, I mark up this particular boxed up area to show how overly bought we are and how extreme we are in terms of a euphoric state within the dollar index back in 2014, 2015-ish period is, you can see the RSI actually hit a high of 82. And why is this important? You can see over here, the last time the relative strength index on the dollar index was at such a high mark of around 82 was back in 1985 over here. And that was also one of the cyclical high that I've marked up in my previous slide. So you can see over here, whenever the dollar index actually head into an overbought territory above 70, especially on a monthly time frame like the chart I'm showing over here, it brings about a strong significance because it takes a lot of time and euphoria for the RSI to actually hit an overbought zone when we are on a monthly time frame chart. So as you can see over here, when the RSI back in the 1985 actually hit an extreme overbought of 82, the signal to sort of move the market and turn it down into a circular downtrend is this particular bearish engulfing bar that I've marked up by this particular arrow over here. You can see that is sort of a signal from the market that the dollar index is ready to head into a circular downtrend. And the other confirmation that I like to use myself is whenever we get the RSI to hit an overbought, we like to see the RSI actually turning back down below the 70 overbought zone to sort of confirm the turning over property of the price. So we're actually seeing a similar pattern playing out right now to the one in 1985. And same thing again, right now we are moving in a new circular downtrend. And then to top it up, we actually sort of noticed a bearish divergence that's building up within the chart as well. So using the RSI, what a bearish divergence shows is we have the relative strength index actually making a series of lower highs. And then on the flip side, the dollar index actually is making a series of higher highs. So what are the significance of bearish divergence from the RSI, especially when we are coming off from an overbought territory? You can see in the 1997 period, that was when the first sign of a bearish divergence showed up. You can see over here, we have three peaks over here, but those three peaks are lower highs. So RSI hit a peak of 72, followed by 71 and 67, which form our first bearish divergence, whereby you can see dollar index actually continue to make a series of higher highs shown by this particular upward sloping line over here. Ultimately, whenever we get bearish divergence, some sort of market correction is bound to happen, and during that period, we can see the dollar index actually crumble around 9% or so. However, that wasn't that big move of all. Take into consideration, once we factor in the cycles that I just mentioned in the previous slide, it sort of showed us the warning sign of the market top back in 2001. So same thing again, we had a bearish divergence signal happening again. RSI making series of lower highs. So you can see over here 74 followed by 68 and 65 on the RSI. Whereas on the dollar index, it continues to make a series of higher highs again. So ultimately, once the price action confirmed itself, you can see that sort of a signal, the drawdown and the start of the circular downtrend within this particular cycle itself. So the current time, we are actually witnessing a very similar price action pattern as playing out to the one in 2001, which I'll show more in depth in the following slides. But keep in mind the bearish divergence that is showing up right now is very similar to the one we had in 2001. And then couple that with the ADA cycle that I've just mentioned, there's a very high chance that the dollar index is right now already moving into a circular downtrend. And so on this chart over here, basically it's about the same chart, but we zoom it in to show exactly where we think the cyclical high has been formed. So again, this is a dollar index money time frame chart. So to show you how similar we are in terms of the price action to the one we had back in 2001, what we are seeing right now is you can see that it's some sort of a triple top head and shoulders pattern playing out during both periods that is in line with our ADA cycle. So I'll probably just illustrate what happened back in 2001. Head and shoulders pattern was playing out pretty nicely back then. So this was the left shoulder, this was the head, and this was the right shoulder. For those that don't really follow TA, a head and shoulders pattern is a bearish price formation pattern. And the confirmation for the real move to the downside will occur once we get a break of the neckline or the upward trending line shown by this particular blue line. So you can see by factoring cycles together with the bearish divergence signal, as well as price action pattern, we are able to sort of spot the weakening sign within the market. And as you can see, the dollar index started to really crumble once we actually break out below this neckline or this upward trending line during this period over here back in 2001. And then once the particular neckline was broken, you can see the dollar index just fell sort of like in a free fall, and in the total range fell around 36%. So why we are so bearish in terms of the outlook for the dollar index is you can see over here, instead of head and shoulders pattern playing out right now, it's more of a triple top formation playing out. But nonetheless, like I mentioned just now, the 61.8% FIB level that is sort of reacting to the current market price. So you can see the rejection that prices have been putting on at around this 61.8% level mark, as well as the psychological 100 level mark over here. What is interesting is we actually got the neckline or the upward trending line that has been broken to the downside recently, and that happened last month, shown by this particular red bar over here. So that by itself gives us enough confirmation in terms of price action wise, as well as bearish divergence, as well as the 98-month cycle that I just mentioned, that the dollar index is sort of turning over from this prior uptrend and ready to head into a circular downtrend moving forward. So in terms of some near-term target for the dollar index, we are sort of targeting dollar index could easily retest this previous range low of around 93, 13-ish level, and once that is broken, You can easily revisit this 80 level mark again and ultimately to retest the prior decade low of around 72-ish level. And so obviously when we talk about the dollar index itself, we can't leave out the rate hike cycle that's sort of happening right now in the market. So with the Fed hiking just last week again by bringing the rates up to 1.25%, I guess many people will be asking what would be the implication and how would the rate hike cycle affect the US dollar. My answer would be, contrary to popular belief, what we are saying is that the dollar index might not necessarily be affected to the upside whenever the Fed actually hikes interest rate. On the flip side, what we are saying is that once the Fed sort of starts chasing the curve in terms of them lacking behind the inflation as well as unemployment, and when they have no choice but to chase the curve, the implication on the dollar is that the rate hike cycle will actually affect the dollar to the downside rather than causing the dollar to appreciate. And what I mean by that is by looking at a chart, we use the Taylor rule as the benchmark to sort of tell us whether the Fed is ahead or behind the curve. So the Taylor rule actually takes into account some properties such as unemployment rate, inflation rate, as well as output gap to sort of determine the market neutral interest rate. And historically, the Fed has been tracking and trailing following the Taylor rule in terms of interest rate pretty closely. And the correlation kind of snapped only after the subprime crisis back in 2008. So what we want to sort of show here is how the Fed, in terms of them being behind the curve, whenever they start chasing inflation and output gap, the dollar index tend to sell off instead of appreciating. So how do we actually show that? You can see over here, the second bottom panel over here shows the spread between the Fed funds rate and the Taylor rule. Whenever we get a negative spread, shown by the red boxes, a negative spread basically tells us that the Fed funds rate, the orange line, is below the black line, which means the Fed is behind the curve. And just to illustrate a few examples, you can see prior to 1972, there was a whole 13 months of negative spread, which means the Fed funds rate was below the Taylor rule inverted interest rate. It tells us that the Fed is behind the curve. And when you can see over here, when the Fed started to hike their interest rate, as they fell behind the curve, they raised their rates from 3.5% to a high of 13% during that whole period. You can see the implication on the dollar is actually sell off. The dollar actually sold off about 13% during that rate hike cycle of 3.5% to 13%, which was pretty bizarre in a sense. But that kind of a correlation do actually hold up pretty nicely throughout history whenever we realize that the Fed is behind the curve. So another good example to illustrate again is just prior to November of 1976. You can see there was 28 whole months of negative spread, which means the Fed was behind the curve for 28 whole months. You can see once they start to chase inflation and output gap, when they took rates up from 4.75% to a high of 20%, you can see that there's a huge move in terms of the interest rate complex. Even with the huge move in the interest rate from 4.75% to 20%, that didn't really deter selling off in the dollar index. And instead, you can see the dollar index actually suffered 21% drawdown during that period. And so, where we are right now, in terms of the Fed hike cycle that began in December of 2015, 2 years ago, I would say that the Fed again is behind the curve, and this time around, I think it will be worse than the previous few times because we are right now in an unprecedented area. Well, what I mean by that is you can see it took the Fed 47 whole months before they started to chase inflation and output gap, shown by this negative spread over here. The first rate hike that began more recently was in December of 2015, and that took the Fed 47 months behind the curve before they started increasing the interest rate. This is sort of longest in history. The previous time we were at such a level, it was only 36 months. That was only in May of 2004. So even with the rate hike cycle that has been going on since 2015 December period, where we raised rates from 0.25% to 1.25%, you can see since then, the dollar index has more or less been sort of a flat since December of 2015. And we are not seeing any strength within the dollar index itself, even with the rate hike from 0.25% to 1.25%. And so moving forward, what we are expecting is, even if the Fed were to aggressively hike interest rate as they have mentioned that they would, we believe that the dollar will sort of still stay subdued and sort of depressed because they are behind the curve. And the same kind of market price action for the dollar index should ensue. And like I mentioned, the cycles and the bearish price action within the dollar index is actually suggesting a weaker dollar rather than a strengthening dollar. And hence, on the flip side of all, I'd like to talk a little bit more on gold itself right now. So since we are talking on the US dollar, on the flip side, gold would be a good comparison. So over here, I've shown a chart. The bottom panel basically shows the same chart in the first slide, the dollar index showing the 98-month cycle. And the top chart basically just shows the correlation of gold during the circular downtrend from the dollar index. So you can see over here, gold actually performed pretty nicely whenever we have a weak dollar environment. Pretty nice gain over here, 71%, 6%, 145%, 99% more recently. And hence, if we were to believe the 98-month cycle would sort of play itself out, starting from January of this year, gold should remain well beat moving forward. And we have been talking about gold since about 1 or 2 years ago. And we like to reiterate our target for gold to retest its 1920 high, and that was the all-time high back in 2011, moving forward. And for those that have been following our webinar, we have been showing this chart time and time again. So you can see, just now I've mentioned the cycles within the dollar index itself, but this is the chart that I've also shown time and time again, that the gold chart has follows its own cycle as well. So gold follows a similar AR cycle, but not exactly to each time point, but you get the idea. So instead of forming a cyclical high within every 8 years, gold actually forms a cyclical low within every 8 years and head into a circular uptrend. So this is basically like a mirror image of what I've shown in the first chart with the circular cyclical high, cyclical top chart that I've shown in the dollar index. So everything lines up pretty nicely in terms of bullish picture on gold. We test its 1920 high, as well as the bearish view on US dollar itself. And just to show a few more supporting evidence of why we are bullish on gold and why we like gold, is because of real interest rates. So what we found out is that real interest rate, whenever we have a real interest rate that is moving into a declining environment, and especially when the real interest rate dips into a negative territory, heading below zero, gold tends to perform very nicely as an inflation hedge during those circumstances. Before I move on, the way we define real interest rate is we use the US 10-year Treasury U less the headline CPI data, and it gives us this particular graph over here at the bottom panel. So just to illustrate what I mean by that, I've demarcated the vertical lines to show every single point in time whereby the real interest rate actually first dip into negative territory. You can see the vertical lines actually provided very good buying opportunity signals in terms of when to get into gold. So you can see the first signal came in August of 1973. That was the first time when the real interest rate actually dipped below zero. It provided a good buying opportunity, and during that period, you can see just a short time span, gold actually appreciated 72%. Same thing happened again in November of 1978. During that period, gold actually performed 237% to the upside. And then three more recent examples happened in 2005, 07, and 11, whereby gold actually rallied for 107%, 24%, and 19% respectively. So why is it interesting right now, you might ask? It's because the signal got triggered very recently in January of this year again. So our real interest rate has been declining since 2015. And we have actually first triggered and hit into negative territory back in January of this year. We hit a low of minus 0.03, and we believe that provided a very good signal that gold is ready to hit into a circular uptrend, like I just mentioned, in terms of cycle. And even since then, performance of gold has been pretty good since end of Jan. We are still up pretty nicely, and if this correlation were to hold, like I mentioned, I'd like to reiterate our target for gold moving forward for the next 2 to 3 years would be to retest this 1920 high that we have seen back in 2011. Another thing that we look at to support our gold thesis is the XAU to S&P 500 ratio. So what the XAU tells us is, the XAU, for those that don't know, is the Philadelphia Gold Silver Mining Index, which basically comprises 30 gold and silver miners that is listed on the Philadelphia Stock Exchange. So over here, I have the ratio against S&P 500. And what we notice is that whenever we get a reading, a ratio that was below 0.03, it tells us that gold and silver miners are relatively cheap as compared to the S&P 500 companies. And on the flip side, when we get a ratio of 0.01, anything above that level, the miners are actually relatively more expensive than the S&P 500 companies. So what it's showing is that whenever we hit both extremes, the reversion to the mean kind of a pattern plays out because market moves in the waves, doesn't just go up in a linear fashion. And so whenever the reversion to the mean pattern plays out, when we are at an extreme point, be it at the extreme high or extreme low point, it sort of tells us where gold prices will hit into. So you can see back in October of 2000, that was when the ratio sort of hit the extreme low of 0.03. And once the reversion to the mean kind of pattern plays out over here, you can see it signaled that gold was ready to hit into a start of a new circular uptrend. And during that period, short time span of around 7 years, gold appreciated 261%. And then subsequently, more recently, back in November of 2015, you can see the ratio actually dipped below the 0.03 mark, hit a new record low of 0.02. And once we see the reversion to the mean start taking place, you can see gold actually pretty nicely bottomed out in December of 2015, 2 years ago, at the low of 1046. So even as of the current reading, the ratio stands at 0.0328. It's still showing that we are at an extremely low part of the ratio, and that we believe that the reversion to the mean pattern hasn't been completed yet. And moving forward, we should expect this ratio to continue to revert back to at least 0.01 to 0.15, or even to retest this extreme high of 0.18. And so, same thing over here, it supports a bullish view on gold to retest this 1920 high. And just for your interest, probably some signal to actually take profit off the line in gold is whenever we get the ratio start to retest this extreme high of 0.18. So that will be the area to look out for in terms of timing to take profit for gold whenever we get there. But that shouldn't be a worry right now, because it could easily take 2 to 3 years for us to hit that level. So you can see back in around 2011, where the all-time high was being signaled, you can see the ratio was at an over extreme level over here at 0.18. And once it reverts to the mean back from the extremely high level, gold sort of a follow suit and form its all-time high. And last but not least, another supporting evidence of why we are bullish on gold, we took a look at the commercial short contracts from the COT report, the Commitments of Traders report. So bring our attention to the bottom panel over here, which shows you the CFTC gold commercial short contracts. So in layman terms, what this shows is what the miners are doing in terms of their hedge book. So we are sort of watching what the miners are holding onto their position in terms of the short contracts. So what we notice is whenever we get a reading below 168,000, it tells us that the miners are extremely exposed to the gold price movement because they are least hedged in anticipation of a higher gold price. And then on the flip side, whenever the reading gets above 391,000 contracts, it tells us that the miners are extremely hedged, which means they are sort of anticipating a lower gold price. So what this chart tells us is whenever we hit a reading of minus of 168,000 or lower, like the one that we had in November of 2008, you can see the miners pretty perfectly caught the bottom in gold prices back then. And during that period, it sort of appreciated 135% when we hit the extreme low part of the hedge book. So why the miners, they themselves sort of have the predictive power in terms of where gold prices will be? My sort of explanation would be, since the miners are the one that is operating in the physical realm of things, they know better in terms of the physical supply and demand of the market, which is why they would have a better sensing of where gold prices will be in the near future. And hence, this particular chart tells us a lot in terms of where the prices will be in the future for gold. So same thing again happened when the CFTC gold commercial short contracts hit an extremely low again back in December of 2015, 2 years ago. It way surpassed these 168,000 contracts. When it started to revert back to the mean, you can see what happened is gold again bottomed out pretty nicely back in December of 2015. And during that short time span of 6 months or so, gold appreciated 25%. But however, on the flip side, when the miners are extremely hedged, which means they are having short contracts exceeding 391,000 contracts, it sort of signals that the gold market is ready to hit the correction. And what I mean by that is even more recently, you can see the bull market run that we had in last year ended around July of 2016. There's been sort of a foreseen by the commercial miners themselves, because you can see over here, their short contracts hit an extreme high of around 470,000 contracts. And when that happens, it's obvious that the miners are extremely hedged in anticipation of lower gold price, which was what happened. So you can see, since July of 2016, gold price corrected 16% during that period. And then probably I'll just illustrate one more point whereby whenever the miners are extremely hedged, you can see how the miners actually caught the all-time high in gold prices back in 2011 again, when the miners are extremely hedged over here. So back in August of 2011, when the miners exceeded the 391,000 short contracts amount, that sort of demarcated the market peak within the gold market itself. So what are the significance in terms of this chart? Right now, I would say that the gold market, in terms of the short contracts from the miners' perspective, remains relatively neutral. We are neither at the extremely exposed region or extremely hedged region. So believe that the circular bull market within gold is still pretty healthy, and we should continue to see upward strength within gold itself to retest the 1920 level. In terms of same thing again, signaling to take profit for gold itself, things to look out for again is once we hit extreme high from the commercial short contracts exceeding 391,000 contracts, that will be the time to sort of look out for to take some profit off the table whenever we get there. And so in summary, for my part, I'd like to reiterate that we are very bullish on gold and silver with the facts I just explained in the earlier slide in terms of the weakening trend within the dollar index, whereby it's heading into a circular downtrend right now, as well as how gold is behaving positively when we have a negative real interest rate environment, as well as the extremely low XA to S&P 500 ratio and the reversion to the mean part. And last but not least, the COT commercial short contracts right now remaining at a neutral level, which still supports a bullish case for gold and silver. And then on the bearish side, we are bearish on the dollar index, purely on a cyclical point of view, because right now we are in the early stages of the new cycle, whereby the dollar index is just transiting into a new circular downtrend that could easily last for 2 to 3 years to target the previous decade low of around 73-ish level. So some investable instrument that you can actually take to profit, to capitalize on as on these ETFs. So this first group over here shows the ETF that are related to gold and silver. So GLD is the ETF for gold, SLV is the ETF for silver, and these three other subjects are GDX, which is the big boys within the gold mining space, GDXJ, which is the juniors within the gold mining space, and then last but not least, SILJ, which is more of a pure silver play. And then lastly, for those that want to short the dollar index, an ETF that can be used to capitalize on it would be the UDN, which is the PowerShares US Dollar Index Pair. And hence with that, I'll pass the rest of the time to Saiting to talk a little bit more on the emerging markets and how they tend to behave positively under a weak dollar environment.
Hi, very good afternoon to everyone. I'm starting here, Macro Research. So I think Jeremy has done a lot of the heavy lifting in terms of our case on the bearish dollar or the weakening dollar environment. So with that, I'll just try to link that thesis, investment thesis, to how the equity markets will play out. So today we are looking specifically at the emerging markets, and we do see some investment opportunities here. We go straight into the first slide. Okay, so emerging markets, we all know emerging market has a little bit of the negative correlation with US dollar, and we see that on a weekly basis, from the chart itself, you can see it's quite telling. Every time the dollar index itself starts appreciating, you see your emerging markets either being stagnant or actually heading downwards. So charts tell us one thing, but when we look into the correlation on a weekly basis, emerging markets and the US dollar since 1990 has been negative 0.223. Simply put it, that means every time dollar strengthens, your emerging markets tends to underperform, and when dollar weakens, your emerging markets tends to outperform. So we move more in depth into emerging markets. So here we compare, the blue line is still the dollar index, and the green line here we're looking at is actually your emerging markets over your developed markets, or MSCI World Index, which includes just the developed markets. So the green line, how do you read this graph, is very simple. As the green line drops or falls, it indicates that the emerging markets underperform the developed markets. As the green line appreciate, it shows that the emerging markets actually tend to outperform the developed markets. So looking at this, we know that we have actually demarcated some peak and trough of the US dollar, and we see that every time the dollar starts to strengthen, your emerging markets actually fell by quite a bit. The first case happened in August of 1995, whereby emerging markets fell by at least 62%. And when the dollar peaked in 2002, January of 2002, then starts to fall, you see your emerging market actually picking up pace and actually having a gain of more than 100%, in fact 138%. So on and so forth. And what we realized with this is the more telling thing, or the more important thing that we want to share, is that this cycle tends to last for years, meaning that on average, when the dollar strengthen or the dollar weakness, and vice versa, which is your emerging market strength or weakness, it usually happens on average, it lasts about six years. That means this is quite a persistent trend. Once an emerging market starts to outperform the developed markets, we see a persistent trend of at least 6 years. So this tells us that, this will answer a question where I think a lot of people are asking, emerging markets have been outperforming since late 2015 or in the early 2016. So are we too late in the game? My answer to that is that we are actually still quite early. As long as the thesis of the dollar weakness continues to hold, we believe that this might just be the start of emerging markets, outperformance of the emerging markets. So we would like to highlight here as well is that not all emerging markets are the same. Since the ascent of emerging markets in end of 2015, we see here that Brazil and Russia has been making very good progression. In fact, they have actually hit a peak and have retraced back a bit. Brazil, so if we were to rebase them since January 2016, that's when the emerging markets starts to have a better performance or start to have a turnaround. We see that Brazil has actually been performing up to March this year, at least an 80% increase, and since then they have actually retraced by quite a bit. Russia is still the same thing as well. You see that they have increased by at least 50% before retracing. However, you look at the other emerging markets, especially the Asian emerging markets, you look at China, India, EM, emerging markets in Asia, as well as Greater China. These are all, to be fair, the purple line, the light blue line, and the orange line, which is your China, EM, and Asia, and also your Greater China, they are generally very dependent on the China market. But you could see that since the boom of the emerging markets, they have been steadily increasing. They have not skyrocketed like your Russian on your Brazil equity markets, and they are continuing to growing from strength to strength. So our conclusion here is that actually we feel that looking at emerging markets, we need to look into the underlying emerging economies, and there's a few factors. Generally on a broad basis, we look at three things. It needs to have a fundamentally sound economy. We prefer to have a price momentum behind it. And second is, and the third and final is that the valuation must be fair or reasonably cheap. So first point we look at is actually the economical fundamentals, which is also very important. Besides the GDP, besides inflation, what else do we look into? We're actually looking at current account surplus, which will translate to a positive balance of trade. Second thing we look into is actually the large amount of foreign currency reserve. The third, which is a bit qualitative, is a predictable and reliable government. And the fourth is also very qualitative, which is the transparent and responsiveness of the monetary policies, which is also their central bank. So the table here that we have actually shown depicts the first two points, which is more quantitatively easy to read. So if you look at it, you could see that it was quite easy to explain why Brazil, after a good run, is actually falling apart. It's because if you look at the Brazil, the role of Brazil, they actually run a current account deficit. I mean, in any emerging markets, you know, we all know that emerging markets are generally export-driven nation, and you are expected to at least maintain a positive balance of trade. But for them, they're running actually a current account deficit, you know, and that doesn't tell them very well. Russia, you know that they are positive because of their oil exports. And the next thing you want to look at is actually, so is India and Indonesia, if I could point out to them, to you the current account as a percentage of their GDP, a negative showing a current account deficit. The next point is looking at their foreign currency reserves. So based on their foreign currency reserve, you know that you look at how strong and powerful China is. Therefore, we're actually very positive on China. Their balance sheet is, their central bank balance sheet is actually quite large. In fact, one of the largest after the G3 economy. You have Hong Kong, such a small nation with such a huge foreign currency reserve. But then, if I were to point out again, you look at the central bank of Brazil and its foreign currency reserve, it's only at a 36 US dollar billions of US dollar. And that's not a very huge amount. If you were to compare that to Singapore, a very small economy, very small GDP, but yet we have about 264 billions of US dollar. That tells us about the strength of the monetary, the strength of the central bank in executing their monetary policies. So here, it doesn't paint a very good picture of emerging market. Therefore, this leads us to the next point, which is price momentum as of now on a weekly basis. The graph here is easy to interpret. I think it's quite foolproof. On the top right-hand quadrant, we actually have the leading economies. The leading equity markets. Bottom right, the weakening. Bottom left is lagging, and the top left is improving. This actually is a bit like the RRG graph, but it's actually what we have done proprietarily to compare markets. So, how do we interpret the graph? It's very simple. Those that's actually on the leading quadrants are actually having a very strong momentum in relative to the other markets that we are comparing. And in this case, we're actually comparing a global markets. That means not only just your emerging markets, we're actually comparing the US markets, the European markets, as well as the Japan markets. We are not showing the US and as well as the European markets because they are all in the lagging economy. And what I'm trying to showcase here is that within the leading economy, leading quadrant is where you can find all your Asian index. And we also highlighted the Russia and as well as the Brazil emerging markets. As you can see that they're actually in the lagging quadrant, which is one of the worst quadrant you want to put your money in right now. So this tells us quite simply that Asian markets are leading global equity markets right now. That also ticks the box for actually having a favorable price momentum. The third and final piece of this is actually your market value. So using our proprietary research as well, we have concluded that, you know, as of now, end of May, we're looking at monthly data here. We see that out of the top five ranked valuation, in terms of valuation, 6 out of the 10 equity indexes actually in Asia. Particularly, we have our Hang Seng China Enterprise Index, which is on top. How do you view this graph? Very simple. The one on the left is the cheapest. The one on the moving right, we get more expensive. We have actually compiled a few of these data in terms of valuation factors. So we are comparing not only across equity markets, but also across their individual historical valuation history. So with that, we see that the economical fundamentals supports certain emerging market, particularly China. So to conclude here, the dollar weakness should lead to better performance in the emerging markets. Not all emerging markets are the same. We look into the economical fundamentals, with strong fundamentals such as a large account, current account, as well as a huge foreign currency reserve. We look at price momentum and market valuation, which easily points out that the East Asian markets, China, Greater China, is very attractive. So combining all these, the three factors that we just mentioned earlier, economical fundamentals, strong price momentum, as well as cheap valuation, we believe that Greater China market will be a good investment consideration at this point of time. Therefore, we are recommending investable instruments such as the in the SGX market, which is the Deutsche Bank Tracker, China 50 US dollar, as well as the Deutsche Bank tracker MSCI China, which is the tracking the MSCI China as a whole. On the American, these are all ETF by the way, and in the American exchange, looking at MCHI, which is the tracking the iShares MSCI China. Do note that the two in that we have stated here, the investment vehicle of the SGX, they are not EIP, so they are all SIPs because they use derivative to mimic the returns of the underlying index that are tracking. This is a separate slides. This showcase what our view are as of this week and our key traits that we are looking at. Not only just technicals, not only macros, but we are looking also from our fundamental perspective, our fundamental analysis. So first point here is that the economical momentum is rolling over with a global economical indicators continues to soften. Second point here is that a weak SIBOR will be a headwind to the banking sectors. Therefore, to conclude, these are the fundamental picks that we are having. Number one, buy you. We have a coverage on Asian paid TV. Corsos, retail trust, as well as Capital DC REITs, or buying momentum. These are all stocks under our coverage. We have CDL and Capital Land. And of course, from the macro point of view, buy weak US dollar and strong emerging markets, we have Cinemas Land. And we had a trading note which we published recently, which is on Wheelock Properties. That's a trading buy on that. So with that, we come to the end of the presentation. We'll be looking through, we already have some questions here, so we'll be looking through some of these questions, and hopefully we can get to answer most of them. Okay, we just like to clarify on a few questions that was asked earlier on. I believe we've answered a question. One of the questions pertaining to if the Fed were to continue increasing interest rate going forward, isn't this bullish on the US dollar? I think Jeremy have actually explained this, which is the same as the second question that we're having. What is the impact on the Fed tightening on the dollar strengthening? I think Jeremy has explained this as well.
Hi guys, Jeremy here again. So there's a question asking what will happen when the Fed starts to reduce its balance sheet $6 billion a month moving forward, and the implication of it. So obviously, this was a new piece of news that came out last week when the Fed released their FOMC meeting announcement. So obviously, you can see that new piece of news actually triggered some dollar strength within the market, as well as the same time gold selling off. So what is sort of my expectation is right now there is just an announcement that they are going to do the $6 billion a month cut on it. But whether we actually get a timeline of when they are actually going to do it or not, it still remains a big, big question mark. So obviously what they are saying is that they are sort of seeing and trying their best to actually do the balance sheet reduction by the end of this year. So I think we will have to wait another 6 more months before we can see more significance or more clarity in terms of the Fed really going about and cutting their balance sheet. So if that really were to happen, then there is a high chance that we might see some weakness within, I mean some strength within the dollar itself and some weakness within gold. However, moving forward, what's important is still the forward guidance from the Fed, whether are they able to actually keep up with the pace of the balance sheet reduction or not. And also at the same time, we still have to take into consideration the Fed rate hike cycle that's happening in mids. Right now it's at 1.25%, and the FOMC dot plot is actually stating that at the end of the year, we are actually going to see another rate hike to 1.5%. So all of this still remains a big question mark, and whether we actually are able to achieve that or not, it still remains a big question mark. So however, on the flip side, if none of this were to materialize, you can imagine the real impact on dollar itself as well as gold. So if we get a big, big miss and the Fed sort of disappoints the market, then that will be a big, they will cause a knee-jerk reaction within a weak dollar as well as a strong gold when that happens. So moving forward, I think it's important for us to keep a watch on what the Fed does.
Hi, there's a question on investable instruments, which is the O87 gold ETF that's listed on the SGX. Is it a good instrument to long exposure for gold? With regards to that, the ETF here in Singapore is actually the same one that's actually listed on the US, which is they are all fitting into the same UCITS fund. So therefore, price-wise, you might find that there might be a bit of a mispricing on a daily basis, but it will definitely be reprice at the end of the day back to its NAV. So in short, the answer is actually it is a direct exposure to go as this fund actually holds physical, invest into a physical gold and not in paper gold.
Sorry, there's a question on the target price for USD and SGD. We do not provide such target.
Okay, there's a question here on the MSCI in decision to include the China equity, and how does it affect the China ETF that we are recommending. Okay, currently all the China ETF that we are recommending are not the A share. So if you look through the all these ETF and the underlying index that they're tracking, right, they are not directly, they have the mandate to invest in A shares, but most of their holdings are not in A shares. When you're talking about the MSCI decision to include the China equities, I believe you're talking about them including the onshore A shares into the MSCI universe. In fact, MSCI, there is an index itself which is called the MSCI China A index that only tracks the onshore equity markets, and I can tell you that that market has been getting a lot of beat down. Whereas we're actually recommending the hit shares as well as Greater China, such as the Taiwan and part of and Hong Kong shares as well. That means at least corporates in listed in Hong Kong that are actually having businesses or their top line is actually being affected in the China market. So these are the China ETF, which is defined by MSCI and how they look into the China ETF. So at this moment, when you're talking about inclusion, I believe you're also talking about the MSCI emerging markets, including China A shares. That has actually no effect on our investment decision on the MSCI China ETF itself. There's a question here that asks, is there a risk that the US 10-year yield rate increase going forward such that the negative rate, real rate situation doesn't hold anymore, right? The short answer to this is actually yes, there is a risk that, as the yields of the US 10-years increases, the negative rates will not hold. But if you could look at what is currently happening in the market is that ever since the Fed embarked on their tightening journey, the 10-year yields have actually not budged a lot. In fact, they have been dropping. Only the short end yield curve, which is the 2 years treasuries, have been increasing in terms of their yield. But this is a topic for another discussion. I mean, Alan Greenspan calls it the saving glut conundrum. But but in short, we are not seeing market react in such a way, but yes, there is a risk that the US 10-year yield will increase, thus making the negative real interest rate situation not hold.
Yeah, in addition to that, probably I'll just move back to the chart that I've shown in terms of my negative real interest rate. So just to illustrate the point about if we were to head back to a positive real interest rate environment, how will it affect gold? So I can see there's a very good example that is if that particular case situation whereby the real interest rate hits back to positive, there was actually a good example that happened in August of 2005. You can see over here, there was I think only 1 or 2 months whereby the real interest rate dipped below the negative mark. Same thing over here, it fell 0.03, negative 0.03, and subsequently reversed back up to positive territory. However, I think the scare of a negative real interest rate is enough to sort of flog the market anticipation and expectation to sort of bring their money back into gold. And as you can see over during this period, just 1-2 months of negative interest real interest rate actually caused gold to appreciate 107% throughout that period. If that scenario were to play out, which means the real interest rate from here moving forward will continue to stay positive, a similar price action might actually happen to the one that we have in August of 2005, whereby gold should continue to sort of experience a rally rather than a slumber.
Okay, we have a question on the impact on the US equity markets when the Fed decides to proceed with the sell off the your question is when they start to wind down their balance sheet, right? It really depends on the even the Fed itself inside their statement, they already mentioned that it really depends on the economical backdrop. It's not a must do thing. They are still looking at the economical outlook of such things, and we do believe that if they do it in a gradual manner and not rush into this winding down of balance sheet, potentially it will not have a adverse impact on the equity market, but that also depends on how the other market participants view this. But as of now, we believe that such a decision which has been made has been really been priced into the market. There's a question on since there's a bullish view on gold, what's Philip's view on CNMC gold mine? As you all know, we have coverage on CNMC gold mine. Currently, we are still recommending a buy call with a target price of 44 cents. We can't go because of time constraint, we won't be going into details about it, but do read our updated report. Currency on currency, we are not, we will not be giving any comments on currency and strength, any strength in currency.
Okay, there's a question again regarding the real interest rate, especially on since 2011. Why did the negative real rates didn't really cause gold to spike up? So could I mention what the impact on gold is when we have a real interest rate that is moving in a declining or a negative fashion? Is it does spectacularly well when the real interest rate is actually declining, which means it's falling, and more so when it's heading into a negative territory. So what we are seeing is the first phase of the move downwards and heading into a negative territory is the phase whereby the early stages of the gold bull market run. So you can see over here the 2011 stages is actually sort of nearing the end, because real interest rate has been falling since 2009. You can see a steep drop from this particular point about 6% to a low of 1.9%. And what we notice is whenever we get a steep move in terms of the real interest rate hitting an extreme low, when it rebounds, that sort of signifies a top within gold itself. So for example, like you mentioned over here, 2011, when we hit the extreme of -1.9 and when it starts to revert, and when the real interest rate starts to steepen or sort of move up in a gradual fashion, you can see that sort of spelled the top in gold itself here. At the same time, same thing over here back in the 1980s period. Like I mentioned again, what we want to capture is the initial stages of the declining phase of the real interest rate, as well as the real interest rate dipping into negative territory. The first initial stage is what we want to capture. However, nearing the end of it, whenever we hit the extreme low part of it, when it starts to spike back up, that sort of signals the end of the gold bull market. So I think where we are right now, we are still pretty much very early in the real interest rate complex in terms of where we are, coming on just from about 2.5% to the extreme low of only -0.3%. So in terms of room to run, for the real interest rate to decline further, I think there is still room for the real interest rate to decline further, which is why just from the piece from the real interest rate complex, we are bullish on gold. And obviously to retest this 1920 high in line with our 8-year cycle that we have mentioned time and time again for gold. Okay, there is no more question. We'll end today's webinar here. Thank you very much for tuning in to today's webinar. We'll see you again in 2 weeks' time, since next Monday is a public holiday. So see you again in 2 weeks' time. Thank you.